Father God, we just thank you for being able to meet and sing your praise, Lord. We thank you for the freedom to just be able to express our love for you in an open place, God. We pray that this worship, Lord, is able to bring us into your throne room and bring us closer to you, and that your glory is shouted amongst the hills here, Lord. Lord, we praise you, and we thank you, and we love you. In your name, amen. Forever you are faithful, forever you are strong. With that hope, we are encouraged. Father, now we thank you. We look forward into this season of thankfulness, of Thanksgiving coming up, and we thank you for the sacrifice that you have given us on the cross. Lord, you give us that hope, you give us that joy and that peace, Father.
Inside.
us, Lord. We look at that promise, that redemption that you gave us on the cross, and the response is to pour ourselves out for you, Lord. Allow us to pour ourselves out and surrender everything that is not of you, Father. Lord, you are more than enough for us, Lord. Because of that, Father, we thank you and we praise you. And we say, we recognize how great you are, Father. would just lift up praises to our God today.
God, how great
Lord. How great are you, Lord? Lord, your name is worthy to be praised, to be shouted above the voices of this world. Allow us to reflect on that and praise you every day for the chaos, for the fact that you are constant in the chaos, for the fact that you are the hope in the hopelessness, Father. We praise you and we love you and we thank you, Father. In your name, amen.
Good morning, you guys can have a seat.
Welcome to Pine Valley Community Church. How is everyone this morning? Three people are good. Super cool. One person is awesome. How's everybody else doing this morning? All right, very cool. I got some thumbs up way back in the back. That means they can hear me. Give me thumbs up way back in the back. Awesome. Super cool. Thank you so much for being here this morning. Again, welcome to Pine Valley Community Church. Let's give this worship team a hand. Yeah, they did a lot of work this week trying to fix some of those kinks in the sound that we had last week. Plus, they got here like 8:30 this morning and brought everything out and all that good stuff. And so just thanks a lot, you guys. Thank you, Michaela. So I wanted to highlight a couple of announcements for everybody today. One is PVCC, Pine Valley Community Church, elder nominations. There is a form on the table right there for elder nominations. We're looking at our annual meeting sometime right after the new year, and we will be planning on bringing on at least one, maybe two more elders of Pine Valley Community Church. So if you have any nominations, members are supposed to be the ones to make the nominations, and the nominees are supposed to be a member of Pine Valley Community Church for 1 year or more. But there's a form there that gives all the information, and then you can write the name. You can give it to me, you can give it to Pastor Joe, you can give it to one of the elders, you can put it in the offering plate. Any one of those things will work. So again, thank you very much. Elder nominations are right there on the table. Christmas is coming, but so is Thanksgiving. Are you guys thankful right now at all? Thankful for the greatness of God, thankful for just his unchanging love. I'm thankful just for the trees and the colors on the trees around Pine Valley lately. That looks pretty awesome. I love fall. We've been waiting for it. We thought we were just going to skip straight from summer to winter, and then last week we thought we were going to go back to summer, but that's kind of how 2020 has been, right? Like, it's just kind of all over the place, but we're rolling with it. But Christmas, I wanted to mention one last time up here on a Sunday, Operation Christmas Child, the shoe boxes. If you have brought gifts for kids, we really, really appreciate it. We actually have over 200 boxes at this point, which is super cool. We would love 200 more. Don't laugh. That's not a joke. We would love 200 more. So if you have not done a shoebox or 200, please do a shoebox or 200 today. Mary's right there. You could talk to her with any questions that you have for Operation Christmas Child. You can also decide to just go down to the Dollar Tree and buy a bunch of toys and buy some kind of box to put them in, and then you can bring them back up here. She's going to be collecting two more times. She's going to be collecting this afternoon after church, I believe, from 1 to 3, and then she's going to be collecting tomorrow from 9 a.m. to noon, and then the boxes got to be sent out of here. So make sure you get that done. If that's been on your list and you've been thinking about doing it, or if you know, you're just starting to think about doing it, you got plenty of time. We would love it. It's an awesome ministry. So again, thank you, Mary, for heading that up. You guys might see the boxes inside the church. Yeah, give her a huge hand, because it is. She's been here every day for the last several days, just collecting and things like that. So super, super cool. One other thing, we have a new little person in our church body, from what I've heard. And we don't have the screen out here. Normally, we'll put their picture up and everything. So just to prove that he's really little, there he is. See how little he is? His name's Owen Devin Black. Jeff and Allison Black had their baby just a few days ago. So we can give them a big hand. Don't look around for them because they're not here. They're not going to bring a newborn that's just a couple days old to church. But grandparents are right there. Aunt and uncles are back there. So we're super excited for them. He's doing great. I believe he was 6 pounds, 1 ounce. Is that correct? 19 and a quarter inches long. Yeah, about the size of a burrito maybe. I saw some pictures of him next to some burritos. And either that's a small baby or that's a big burrito. Might be a little bit of both. I don't know. But again, Welcome to Pine Valley Community Church. Pastor Joe's going to be up here in just a few minutes. You can take a few minutes to meet and greet someone, give someone a high five, tell them you're glad they're here. Whatever you guys want to do. We'll see you in a couple minutes.
Well, good morning. It is great, great to be here. Can you hear me in the back? Okay, amen. Amen. Very excited about being able to have us participate again in Operation Christmas Child and the opportunity that it is for us to have an impact around the world, as our God is the God of all creation in this whole world. And we are part of His unshakable kingdom and the advance of that kingdom. And this is a great opportunity to be a part of that. And so thank you for your participation in that. It's good to see you. Appreciate your graciousness in allowing us to be away for several weeks. And it took every day, but the praise is that we got done in those days what we needed to do. And so we're very grateful for that. Amen. Amen. So appreciate your prayers, your kindness in that way. A lot has happened in the last weeks, and what is now taking place appears insane if it was not evil. And I certainly believe we need to call it what it is, and then also respond as those who belong to our Lord Jesus Christ. So let's now turn to our Lord and to His Word, and let's pray. Lord, we thank You. In fact, we acknowledge the splendor of Your majesty, and that You are great beyond our imagination, and all will know Your greatness. Lord, we thank You that we are gathered here today as Your people in the dedication of our lives to You. We thank You that You have revealed who You are, and You've told us the end from the beginning. And we want to recognize that You don't change. You haven't changed. You're the same yesterday and today and forever. And Lord, we ask that You would help us to see You as You really are and respond to You as You really are, and to be grateful and to stand in awe and reverence because of what You have done in love for Your creation, for humanity, in light of that reality. And we pray all of this in You, our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, I'd ask you to turn in your Bibles to Leviticus 10. Leviticus 10. That's where we're going to be this morning. And God doesn't change. He is the same. In fact, the author of Hebrews tells us that Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. God says, I do not change. Now, what God has done in history, what He's done in the story, with the covenants He's made with humanity, they do and they have changed. But who God is, His character, His attributes do not change. And we need to be aware of that and how we relate to God. Because in today's modern culture, we have missed understanding who God is and what it means to be in His presence and to have His presence with us. God's presence is not to be taken lightly. Now today we're coming back to the book of Leviticus, and we need to look at what takes place in the context of the story, because the story in the book of Leviticus is revealing to us the world as it really is, humanity as humanity really is, life as it really is, God as God really is. And this morning we're going to be given insight into God as God really is. And that might be a lot different or a lot more than what you might think. Now, we left off in Leviticus 8 and 9, and we said that that passage or that section of Leviticus is arguably the center point of the book and the climax. After Israel's failure to listen to and to obey God and to meet God and enter into a covenant with him at Mount Sinai, and then after their rebellion with the golden calf, the Lord was ready to destroy Israel, but Moses intervened. And the Lord relented from destroying them. But he was not going to be present with Israel, which was also not a good thing. And Moses interceded, and he also asked the Lord to relent from that and to be with them, which was God's purpose and his plan from the very beginning. And he said this, have it in your notes, if you take out your notes, if you haven't taken them out already. Exodus 34:9, this is what Moses said. He said, my Lord, if I have indeed found favor in your sight, my Lord, please go with us, even though this is a stiff-necked people. Forgive our wrongdoing and sin, and accept us as your own possession. And because Moses found favor with the Lord did that. And then in Exodus 35 through Leviticus 9, where we've been, this is what the Lord put in place to be able to be present with Israel and to dwell in the midst and to bless them. And instead of Israel being a kingdom of priests, they are now a kingdom with priests. In Leviticus 8 and 9, the tabernacle has been purged, it's been purified, it's been consecrated to be holy space, to be Yahweh's home. And the priest and Aaron and his sons have been purified and consecrated to be Israel's priests. And their clothing and everything that they touch and everything that they use in this sacred space is purified and consecrated as holy. And the tabernacle that is described and how it's to be built in Exodus has now become the tent of meeting in Leviticus, the home of the Lord's presence, this sacred place of the Lord's presence on the earth. And Yahweh has made a way to be present with this stiff-necked people. And for that to take place, there has to be a distance. They have to be kept at a distance with the tabernacle. And for them to have priests and for them to have this symbolic sacrificial system, which is will purge pollution and contamination from the place of the Lord's presence so that he can be in their midst. And then where Moses, as Israel's intercessor, at the end of the book of Exodus, cannot enter the tent of meeting, now with the purification and the consecration of the priesthood and the purification and the consecration of the tabernacle, now Moses and Aaron are able to enter the tent of meeting and to bless the people with the Lord's blessing. And at the end of Leviticus 9, we read, and I'd ask you to just turn back there, verse 22 through 24. We read, and Aaron lifted up his hands towards the people and blessed them. He came down after sacrificing the sin or the purification offering, the burnt offering and the fellowship offering. Moses and Aaron then entered the tent of meeting, that which Moses could not do. And when they came out, they blessed the people, and the glory of the Lord appeared to all the people. Fire came from the Lord and consumed the burnt offering and the fat portions on the altar. And when all the people saw it, they shouted and fell face down on the ground. Yahweh's glory appears with Aaron's service now as priest. And the burnt offering is accepted in this incredible, majestic way, and the people are protected. And this is a reboot of Yahweh's promises and his purposes and his plans for Israel. This is a restart of God's plans for the world. And the tabernacle has become the sacred place of meeting, God with man. And when we come to Leviticus 10, the story continues. But this may now be shocking to you. So let's read. Aaron's sons, Nadab and Abihu, each took his own fire pan, put fire in it, placed incense on it, and presented unauthorized fire before the Lord, which he had not commanded them to do. Then fire came from the Lord and burned them to death before the Lord. Wow. So once again with humanity, here is this new start. It's a fresh start. And once again with humanity, things goes off the rails right away. Nadab and Abihu present unauthorized fire before the Lord. Fire from the Lord's presence came out and consumed them, and they died before the Lord. And this passage doesn't tell us exactly what unauthorized fire was that they were offering, but if we read in the larger context, we have some good insights, a couple of key insights. The first is this, that Nadab and Abihu went into the Holy of Holies, where God's presence had filled the tabernacle. And verse 1 says that they did something which the Lord had not commanded them to do. Now, after this event, there are more laws and stipulations given in chapter 10. In chapters 11 through 15, there are ritual purity and cleanliness laws that are given. And then in chapter 16, the Lord again addresses the priest and picks up with what went wrong with Nadab and Abihu. And so if you turn to Leviticus 16, we'll read the first several verses. The Lord spoke to Moses after the death of two of Aaron's sons when they approached the presence of the Lord and died. And the Lord said to Moses, "Tell your brother Aaron that he may not come whenever he wants into the holy place behind the veil in front of the mercy seat on the ark, or else he will die. Because I appear in a cloud above the mercy seat. Aaron is to enter the most holy place in this way." And then the Lord goes on to prescribe how that's to happen. And the Lord says that Aaron can't come into the Holy of Holies, which is a place behind this thick veil where the Lord's presence appears in a cloud above the mercy seat, above the Ark of the Covenant. And if he does, he will die like his sons. And the Lord goes on to spell out that Aaron must do what he must do on one day a year at the Day of Atonement so that he can enter the Holy of Holies. And if he doesn't do that, or if he tries to enter to the place of Yahweh's presence any other time, the Lord says, he will die. And that appears to be what happened with Aaron's sons. And then secondly, there's another insight into what else went wrong. That is that Nadab and Abihu offered unauthorized fire or incense. And in Exodus 30, the Lord gave directions for the making of this incense and the burning of this incense and all of that with the altar. I have there in your notes, Exodus 30, 8 and 9, just a couple of the verses of where this is all talked about. It says, when Aaron sets up the lamps at twilight, he must burn incense. There is to be an incense offering before the Lord throughout your generations. You must not offer unauthorized incense on it, or a burnt or grain offering. You are not to pour a drink offering on it. And if we had the picture, if we had the screen where we could show the tabernacle, we'll see that the altar of incense is set up in front of this thick veil and curtain that is in front of the Ark of the Covenant, where God's glory, the glory of the Lord, the presence of the Lord dwelt. And according to the Lord's directions in Exodus 30, the incense altar was only supposed to have incense burned on it in a certain way, with coals from a certain place and by a certain person. And Nadab and Abihu didn't do that. And it appears that both of these violations took place. And it seems likely that they brought coals from a common place that is not a holy place, and therefore brought contamination and unauthorized incense or fire into the Lord's presence. In verse 3, we read this. So Moses said to Aaron, "This is what the Lord meant when he said, 'I will show my holiness to those who are near me, and I will reveal my glory before all the people.'" Now here's an important statement about what just took place. Nadab and Abihu are the priests. They're the ones who are near the presence of the Lord, and they're consumed by the fire of the Lord. So now, how did the Lord show his holiness? That is, how did the Lord show the fact that he is completely other and completely unique? He broke out in fire against them. They died. And what is Moses saying? He's saying that God's holiness and that the awesomeness of his presence, his glory, the weightiness of his presence will be revealed to all people. Now that's quite a statement, because the Lord's holiness and glory is expressed here in judgment. And Moses is saying that God's holiness and glory will be expressed in judgment on those who violate or pollute his sacred space. And this brings us to some insights if you turn the page in your notes. The first is this, that Yahweh's sacred space is not to be violated. Where they went behind the veil where Yahweh's presence dwelt. It's not to be violated or contaminated with that which is not holy. Now that happens in Leviticus when anything common comes into the place that has been consecrated as holy. That happens when anything common, that is anything that has not been purged and purified and consecrated to be holy, if that comes into that space where God manifests his presence. And we have seen that the purification offering was given to purge or keep contamination away from the tabernacle, the place of the Lord's presence. And the purpose of that is so that he would not break out against them. That leads to a second insight. Violations of Yahweh's sacred space lead to an outbreak of Yahweh's wrath and death. And the priest, Aaron's sons, they failed to honor Yahweh's presence as holy. And the Lord's presence broke out against them and killed them. Now, big story, little story. Here the Lord has made a reboot and restart of all the promises and plans and purposes for Israel. The priest and the tabernacle are consecrated. Moses and Aaron, as representatives and mediators for the people, are finally able to enter the tent of meeting. They come out and they bless the people with the blessings of the Lord. And the Lord appeared to the people in a cloud, and fire came out from the Lord, that is, out from the Holy of Holies, and consumed the sacrifice that is on the altar out in the courtyard, which shows the Lord's acceptance of those offerings. In other words, what that's saying is, everything is good. It's good. And at the end of Leviticus 9, we go, oh, yay! Woo! Hope for the world. Now, things are different than what God had originally planned for Israel, but at least they're back on track. And God's purpose for Israel with the restoration of the nation, at least they are still God's people, and his purposes are still in play. But now in Leviticus 10, it's like, oh no, not again. From the get-go. And so after Exodus 35 to Leviticus 9, this reboot and this restart for Israel with God's promises to Abe and Ike and Jake, the priests do what they are commanded not to do. They violate the holiness and the glory of the Lord, and the Lord breaks out in fire against them. And this is telling us something about God and something about humanity. And there's a third insight here. There is a great distance between humanity and Yahweh, even on humanity's best day. And the common, that which is not holy, is not able to draw near to God without the Lord's process, provision, protection, and direction. Now, the priest had been consecrated as holy to be able to draw near, to be in the tabernacle, which no one else could, and live. But they went behind the veil, closer than they should. And Moses says that you don't get to treat God's holiness and his glory in any way you want. You don't get to come near to God on your terms. God is so completely other, so completely unique, that you can only be near him through his process and provision and protection and direction. Because what you as a human, even on your best day, bring into his presence is contamination. And the result is an outbreak of his wrath. That's how great the distance is between God and humanity. At the end of verse 3, it says Aaron remained silent. That's in contrast to the loud wailing that usually accompanied mourning. And this would seem to be a determination on his part to follow the procedure that officiating priest should not be mourning. So let's pick up in verse 4. Moses summoned Mishael and Elzaphan, sons of Aaron's uncle Uziel, and said to them, Come here and carry your relatives away from the front of the sanctuary to a place outside the camp. So they came forward and carried them in their tunics outside the camp. And Moses, as Moses had said. Then Moses said to Aaron and his sons Eleazar and Ithamar, "Do not let your hair hang loose and do not tear your garments, or else you will die. And the Lord will become angry with the whole community. However, your brothers, the whole house of Israel, may mourn over that tragedy when the Lord sent the fire. You must not go outside the entrance to the tent of meeting, or you will die. For the Lord's anointing oil is on you." In other words, they have been consecrated to be near and to serve as mediators. And here we have more insights into the priest's role and what God had put in place. The priests are not permitted to mourn. All Israel can, but they're not permitted to. Why? Well, it would appear that they are to continue in their role as representatives and mediators. And if they do not continue in their role, they will die. And the Lord's anger will break out against all of Israel. This in verse 6, "Do not let your hair hang loose, do not tear your garments," those are all parts of mourning, "or else you will die, and the Lord will become angry with the whole community." And this seems to be telling us something about the role of the priest. They must stay in their role and serve as they have been consecrated to serve. And this tells us something about the priesthood that the Lord instituted as a result of Israel's sin and rebellion. In fact, there's a place in your notes where you can write this in. The priesthood has a place in holding back the outbreak of the Lord's wrath upon the people. And again, we get a sense that something is wrong with humanity just by the very nature of who and what humans have become. And that without some sort of mediation, humanity cannot be near the Lord. And it's not appropriate for the priest to grieve because their role is to stand between the people and the Lord. They have been anointed and dedicated and consecrated for that role. And it tells us something about how important the role of the priesthood is, doesn't it? That if it were not for the priest, if it were not for a mediator, if it were not for a representative to stand in their place and offer sacrifices to purge away the contamination and protect the Lord's space from impurity, humanity would be toast. So you can't miss here with Nadab and Abihu how important it is to recognize and respond appropriately to the holiness and glory of God. If the priest, or anyone else for that matter, attempt to draw near God without the Lord's process and provision and protection and direction, the Lord in his holiness and glory will break out against them. That is how much distance there is between God and man. And you can't miss how important the priesthood is. Without the priesthood, there is no hope for Israel. The Lord's anger will break out against them. See, this is a real life and death object lesson. Nadab and Abihu, even though they had been purified and consecrated to be near the Lord's presence, when they violated the Lord's holiness and go into the Holy of Holies, when they didn't honor the Lord's holiness and glory, fire came out from the Lord and burned them to death. Question. Does that create some healthy fear and understanding for you? That you can't just treat God's holiness and glory like it's no big deal? Like you can do just whatever you want and it's no big deal. You might say, well, that is the Old Testament. Now we're living in the New Covenant. Yes, that's true. And there is a huge difference in what has taken place in God's provision in the New Covenant, the way he works with humanity and with our world. But God hasn't changed in who he is. His character, his holiness, his glory, that hasn't changed. And what God has provided to fulfill his promises and purposes in the new covenant has wondrously changed. But now who God is and his holiness and glory and the issues surrounding his holiness and glory That has not changed. There are still consequences for not honoring God's holiness and glory, even in the new covenant, even for people who say that they are believers. That ought to bring some healthy respect and fear before our Lord for how we treat being in His presence. Think about Ananias and Sapphira in the early church, recorded for us in Acts 5. They sold some property and gave some of the money back to the apostles for the church. But they lied and they kept some of the money. They told everyone that, hey, we're giving everything to the Lord, proceeds for the church, but they kept some back. And the Holy Spirit revealed to Peter that Ananias and Sapphira, what they had conspired to do, and the Lord struck them dead on the spot. That's a new covenant, folks. You still do not treat God's holiness and glory with contempt. Think about what the Apostle Paul says to the messed up church in Corinth, where they would come together, quote, for their love feast to celebrate the Lord's Supper that weren't love feasts at all in the way they were treating one another. They had divisions of one, and they were fighting with one another, and they're getting drunk and eating like gluttons with the Lord's Supper. And the wealthy were totally disregarding the poor, and they would eat and leave them nothing. And Paul writes, I have it in your notes, 1 Corinthians 11, for whoever drinks, eats and drinks without recognizing the body, all that Jesus has done and His presence, eats and drinks judgment on himself. This is why many are sick and ill among you, and many have fallen asleep. That's in the new covenant. Paul says you don't dishonor the Lord's presence and provision and holiness and glory. And he says this is why many are sick and ill and many have died. Do you think we should have some healthy fear for how we treat the Lord's presence with us in His holiness and glory? What we say and do? How we relate to other people? This is a bit sobering, isn't it? See, the book of Leviticus is important because it's revealing to us the world as it really is, humanity as we really are, life as it really is, God as God really is. Now, in the rest of the chapter, there's a section, verses 8 to 11, where there are some reminders and instructions for the priest. Verses 12 through 15, there are verses about the priest's role in eating the sacrifices that have been given to them by the Lord. This is important stuff. Verse 16, there's another violation with Aaron's two other sons. And what's taking place is that when the blood of the purification offering was to be brought into the tent of meeting, they were not to eat of that sacrifice. But when the blood of the purification offering was not brought into the tent of meeting, they were to eat of the sacrifice. And here Aaron and his sons did not eat the sacrifice as they should have. So verse 16. Later, Moses inquired about the male goat of the sin offering, but it had already been burned up. He was angry with Eleazar and Ithamar, Aaron's surviving sons, and asked, "Why didn't you eat the sin offering in the sanctuary area? For it is especially holy or most holy." What that means is that it's set aside for you. And he has assigned it to you to take away the guilt of the community and make atonement for them before the Lord. Since his blood was not brought inside the sanctuary, you should have eaten it in the sanctuary area as I had commanded. But Aaron replied to Moses, "See, today they presented their sin or purification offering and their burnt offering before the Lord. Since these things have happened to me, if I had eaten the sin offering today, would it have been acceptable in the Lord's sight?" When Moses heard this, it was acceptable to him. Aaron's sons and were to eat the sacrifice. But in their grief, they and their father didn't. And Moses accepts their answer. But let's notice this. We see the connection here between the priesthood and what happens with the people. Moses says that their eating of the sacrifice had something to do with, in this symbolic system, taking away the people's guilt and providing protection and purification of God's space for them. And we are reminded of the importance of the priesthood. And if you turn your page to the last page there, we're going to talk about that. The importance of a mediator for the people to be delivered from God's wrath. And on this Sunday before Thanksgiving, it leads us to something to be truly thankful for. Now, I don't know about you, but I've had a hard time lately as I look at the state of our world being thankful. I'm concerned, I'm nervous, I'm frightened by the events that are taking place. But this reminds us that there is much more going on to life in our world than meets the eye. And if we know the scriptures and we know the story, Jesus, our victorious King, is coming back to take possession and occupy and rule this world and put it right. And he will reign in holiness and glory. And as we sang, all the world will see it. And he will deal with wickedness, and those who are afflicted by evil will receive relief. I'd ask you to turn in your Bibles to 1 Thessalonians. That's about 9/10 of the way through your Bible. And actually, 2 Thessalonians, excuse me. That's about 9/10 of the way through your Bible. In the letters, 1 and 2 Corinthians, Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians, 1 and 2 Thessalonians. 2 Thessalonians. And let's read beginning at verse 3, chapter 1, verse 3. We ought always to give thanks to God for you, brothers, as is right, because your faith is growing abundantly, and the love of every one of you for one another is increasing. That's the church, folks. Therefore, we ourselves boast about you in the churches of God for your steadfastness and faith in all your persecutions and in the afflictions that you are enduring. That's the church, folks. Many places in the world. Who knows what's going to happen here? Verse 5, this is evidence of the righteous judgment of God, that you may be considered worthy of the kingdom of God, for which you are also suffering. Since indeed God considers it just to repay with affliction those who afflict you, and to grant relief to you who are afflicted as well as to us. When? When the Lord Jesus is revealed from heaven with his mighty angels in flaming fire, inflicting vengeance on those who do not know God and those who do not obey the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. The gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ is that he is the King, he is an authority in the universe, and he's coming back to put this world right. They will suffer the punishment of eternal destruction away from the presence of the Lord and from the glory of his might, when he comes on that day to be glorified in his saints, that's his holy ones, and to be marveled at among all who have believed. Can you give thanks and believe in and put your hope in that truth of what will come, that reality that will come true when Jesus returns to be present on this earth? That's a description of it right there. And you know, we have so much to be thankful for and to rejoice in, because Jesus has become our high priest. He fulfills that role where we can be in the Lord's presence. He is the mediator where we can be in the Lord's presence without fear and without an outbreak of God's wrath. God hasn't changed, but because of Jesus' mediation, we are protected and confident to enter into the holy places, the scripture says, that Jesus opened up for us through the veil. That's Hebrews. In fact, I have some scriptures from Hebrews in your notes. The author of Hebrews writes, "Now this is the main point in what has been said. We have a high priest such as this, who sat down at the right hand of the throne of the majesty in heaven, a minister of the sanctuary and of the true tabernacle, which the Lord has set up. Now he has attained a more excellent ministry, by as much as he is also mediator of a better covenant, which has been enacted upon better promises." A better covenant than the old covenant that we're reading about and seeing in Leviticus. The author continues, Hebrews 10. "But this one, after he had offered one sacrifice for sins for all time, sat down at the right hand of God, from now on waiting until his enemies are made a footstool for his feet. What's going on? What reality is taking place in the world? For by one offering he has perfected for all time those who are made holy. You may want to underline that. Would you look at that? Wow. What a difference between the old covenant and the new covenant that is in Jesus. This tells us who we can be as priests ourselves and how it is that we can be in the Lord's presence. Because of Jesus' one offering of himself, we have been made holy. And we can be in the Lord's holy presence because in Christ we have been made holy. That is, purified, purged, protected, consecrated, made new in Christ. That is holy. We are holy. And we do not have to fear the anger of the Lord's wrath breaking out against us. That doesn't mean that we won't be disciplined as God's children. That doesn't mean we're not going to suffer in this time. But the Lord's wrath is something altogether different. And we are holy. And because we are holy, what Hebrews tells us is that we may draw near God's presence because Jesus has opened that way up for us. And because of this, what Hebrews calls us to is then to walk in faithfulness, faithful perseverance in our God and Father and in Jesus, to walk in faithfulness to them. No matter what comes our way in the days ahead, we are to keep our eyes on Jesus, who has been enthroned as our high priest and king. We are to faithfully endure whatever comes our way in allegiance to him until he returns. And our place is also to be grateful as we live for Jesus' return as his holy ones. The author of Hebrews offers this encouragement. It's the last scripture there in your notes. He writes, "Now the phrase yet once more indicates the removal of what is shaken, namely the things that have been created." It's talking about cosmic judgment here, and it's talking about the old system. "And in order that the things that are not shaken may remain. Therefore, since we are receiving an unshakable kingdom," in other words, one that will not pass away or be taken away, "let us be thankful, through which let us serve God acceptably with awe and reverence, for indeed our God is a consuming fire." Would you think about that this Thanksgiving week, no matter what unfolds? And let this perspective and this appropriate response to reality guide how you live. Let us be thankful, through which, in that thankfulness, let us serve God acceptably and with awe and reverence, for indeed our God is a consuming fire. Will you see the world and life and God as God really is? Will you recognize the great distance between God and humanity and be grateful to Jesus as our high priest and king enthroned in all authority? And Jesus is coming back. He's coming back with consuming fire. But those who are faithful in allegiance and loyalty to Christ are receiving, it says, an unshakable kingdom. Will you think about that this week? Be thankful and serve God in awe and reverence. That's what Nadab and Abihu didn't do. Let's pray. Lord, we recognize that you are the same yesterday, today, and forever. That who you are and your character and holiness and glory haven't changed. That there is a great distance between you and your fallen creation, fallen humanity. Lord, help us to have a healthy fear and recognition of your holiness and glory, not to take the gift of your presence lightly. And Lord, we give thanks for the new covenant. How much better it is than the old covenant. and what you did in coming to us to become our high priest and our king. And that you are God's provision and protection and means of being present with us in order to love and bless us and make us holy in your presence. Lord Jesus, we give thanks. We take hope in the reality that you are coming back with your angels in flaming fire to judge this world and put it right, to set us free and give us an unshakable kingdom which will not be threatened or pass away. And Lord, since we are receiving an unshakable kingdom, help us to be thankful even in the face of difficult circumstances. And in that thankfulness, to serve you acceptably with awe and reverence, recognizing that you, our God, are a consuming fire. Let us keep you in the center of our hearts and minds, who you are, and how it is that we stand in your presence and have become the people of your presence, and that we will live and act as your representatives and ambassadors of your kingdom right now. We pray this in your name, in your presence, Jesus, our high priest and king, who is enthroned in all of authority and coming back to give us your unshakable kingdom. Amen.
If you would all just stand and sing this last song with us. If you don't know the words, concentrate on recognizing how wonderful, merciful our God is.
Always hunger for, oh, our hearts always hunger.
Father God, we just thank you for how wonderful and merciful you are. Lord, allow us to walk in reverence of your name. Father, we recognize that you are almighty. You are infinite, Lord. Allow us to live in that mindset of falling before your throne each day and understanding what it means to be in your presence and honor that, Lord. Allow us not to think of you as our genie in a bottle, but help us to really recognize that you are the creator of the universe, the one that deserves all praise and all glory, Father. Help us to live that and be true to that, Father. In your name, amen.